will come to it slowly, exactly within 1 year of that. So in 1916, there was Mr. Karl Schwarzschild. He was able to solve that equation, Hilbert Einstein equation, and he obtained mathematical solutions, the black hole solutions out of that equation. Okay, and so last year we celebrated 100 years of this discovery of black holes. Okay, and you know, in the recent times, even this year, the Nobel Prize has gone to the guys detecting the gravitational waves. Okay, the LIGO experiment. Okay, so you see, one thing you have to remember: theoretical activities, experimental activities, technology, engineering, everything goes hand in hand. Okay. Nobody is more privileged, nobody is less privileged, you see. Everybody makes contribution in its own way, and then the things progress. Okay. So, this Kip Thorne is exactly working on these very things, including wormholes and so on. A profound general relativist, and but apart from that, I mean, in principle, there have been several huge list of Nobel Prizes or courses on the, because we are talking about fundamentals of physics, so they touch, go across the fields. Okay, and now, so because this theory is so vast and profound, let us have an overview of what is this theory like. Okay, so we try to have an idea about the profoundness of this place. Now, I think the size has to be, it's not the correct, one should fit it into the, it should go page by page. Could somebody help me? Is the full screen. Yeah. Very important point is, as we know that our universe was born 13.7 billion years ago. Here is a diagram. This is the time of Big Bang, and this is the present time where we are living. And it represents the history of the universe. And from here to here, 13.7 billion years have passed. Okay, so we are 13.7 billion years old. Okay, and at the time of Big Bang, when the universe was born, all the fundamental laws of science, all the fundamental laws of physics were also born right at that moment when the universe was born. Okay, it's a different matter that we are now trying to understand them. Okay, and we keep understanding them. So, I will take 1 minute. Can it go page by page, or I just got language? Bit to bit, the picture is being archived. Bit to bit, the picture is being archived. The laws of science were born right at the time when the universe was born. And we would try to know these fundamentals of the nature, fundamentals of physics. The very first thing in this direction starts with great Mr. Newton, Isaac Newton, all of you know. And but we, I want to emphasize the significance of his findings. You see, I have a pen in my hand and it falls down from my hand, and this, there is some law which governs it. Okay? And so here, Newton was the person who told us that the falling of an apple on earth is governed by the same law which governs the motion of the moon in the sky, or the motion of the earth in the sky. Okay? This is a point that we need to catch. So, here is a pictorial representation for the circumference. Mr. Newton watching the falling of an apple, and I it's really irritating. If you people allow me, I might change to my laptop. Because it's I just take available equipment and you two have
I think if you use computer itself tab shayad zyada better rahega.
Maybe
page by page shayad usse aayega.
Okay.
Wo zyada better hai.
Oh, is that so? But it will tie me up with the podium anyway. We try to do it. Fine. So here this shows the motion of earth around the sun, and is the motion of moon around the earth. It is governed exactly by the same law of gravitation which governs the falling of an apple on earth or falling of a pen from my hands in the classroom. Okay? That's the point. So here again you have this the moon's gravitational field is causing the earth to accelerate towards the moon, and earth's gravitational field is causing the moon to accelerate towards the earth. Okay, so you know that the force from earth to moon or moon to earth, they are equal and opposite, and this is governed by the same law that governs the falling of an apple. And then comes the next. Could I move it here? Then I can handle it with my. Now I think I prefer to handle it with my hands. Okay. Otherwise. Okay. So the next landmark after Newton comes to Mr. James Maxwell. About 160 years ago, Mr. Maxwell was able to unify all the well-known laws of electricity and magnetism into the form of electrodynamics or electromagnetism, as it is called, and he was able to put all the well-known laws of electricity and magnetism into the very famous Maxwell's equations. Here are the Maxwell's four equations. All of you would know this is the Gauss's law, divergence law, Gauss's law for electrostatics, Gauss's law for magnetostatics, Faraday's law. So here, the divergence of E is the charge density. Okay, and if you multiply on both the sides by dV and integrate it over the entire volume, on the right hand side you get the total charge. On the left hand side, you have to now make use of the Gauss's divergence theorem. Convert your three-dimensional volume integral into a two-dimensional surface integral, and there you have this. The same thing you have to do here. Here, let me tell you, you see, if you keep catching at each and every point, I will tell you the openings for your research. Okay? So, this is the charge density for the electrons or electrical field. Here, we have put it equal to zero, but if you put it rho of m something, then you would already postulate in your theory the existence of magnetic monopoles. Here the divergence of B is zero, which means if I am considering a cylinder, so the number of lines of force that enter and the flux that is leaving, if they are equal, okay, so that net flux is zero. Okay, but if you postulate that no, I want to have rho of m magnetic charge density, then you have postulated magnetic monopoles in your theory. So far, we have not discovered experimentally any magnetic monopoles. All right. So then this is the if you have a changing magnetic field, you have electrical field, and if you have a changing electrical field, you have magnetic field. So this is Faraday's law, and this is Ampere circuital law. Remember this for the youngest of all of you. This is the Maxwell's contribution to physics, the biggest contribution to physics, E, which is proportional to the D, the displacement current. Before Mr. Maxwell, this term was not there, and this was called as the Ampere's law. And people did not have the correct understanding as to what happened if you put in your electrical circuit also a capacitor. Then what happens to the charge? People did not know. They simply thought the charge was flowing away somewhere. And one didn't know the idea. Now you know, yes, if I have a capacitor in my circuit, LCR circuit, then there is one kind of charge which is deposited on one plate, then equivalent of putting charge develops on this. So here electron is not flowing through the wire. In the rest of the circuit, it's flowing via wires. Okay, there is the actual flow of electrons. But here, in the capacitor plates, it's via induction. Okay, so this is what we know. And all right, so now this Maxwell's equation led Mr. Einstein to the prediction of the existence of electromagnetic waves, okay? And which travel with the velocity of light, and which is given by the strength of the electric and magnetic forces, okay? And you know this famous Poynting's theorem, okay? So you have this kind of a